The Bible teaches us that man should not live by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. And so all of our solutions to life are contained where? In the word of the Lord. And the Bible speaks of that there would be a famine in the land, that there was a famine in the land, but it was a famine of the hearers of the word. And so we celebrate the fact that we want to hear what God has to say. Am I right? So Paul has special attention to the Corinthian church. He birthed it, he nurtured them, he fathered them, he rebuked them, he encouraged them, because he had the church's best interests in mind. And in the sixth chapter of 2 Corinthians, I'm just going to read through this, and this one word I want to capture here. It says, when we then, as workers together with him, beseech you also that you received not the grace of God in vain. It was not fruitless. It was not meaningless. For he says, I have heard you in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I succored thee. That word, S-U-C-C-O-U-R-E-D, sounds like an archaic word, but it does have powerful meaning to it. And I did pronounce it right. I went and double-checked it. And that I succored you. Now, don't think that that means what our modern language means. Let's go a little further. Now, in the second verse again, is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation, giving no offense in anything, that the ministry be not blamed, but in all things approving ourselves as ministers of God, in much patience, in afflictions, in necessities, in distresses. So he's about to give you kind of a long list that approves him as a minister unto the Lord. And this will kind of qualify as to whether or not you would like to be one. And ministers unto God in much patience. How much patience? Much patience. And in afflictions, okay? In necessities, I was in need, in distresses, stress, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tolments, in labors, and in watchings, and fastings, by pureness, by knowledge, by long-suffering, by kindness, by the Holy Ghost, by love unfeigned, by the word of truth, by the power of God, by the armor of righteousness on the right hand and on the left, by honor and dishonor, by evil reporting, good report, as deceivers and yet true, as unknown and yet well known, as dying, and behold, we live, as chastened and not killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, yet possessing all things. Man, this is a heavyweight pedigree, isn't it? What a resume. And then he went over in the 11th verse, and he said, O ye Corinthians, our mouth is open unto you, our heart is enlarged. You are not straitened in us, but you are straitened in your own bowels or your own heart. Now for a recompense in the same, I speak unto you, my children, be ye also enlarged. Then it goes on and said, be not unequally yoked with unbelievers. Paul is pouring out his heart. Could you get that same scripture for me in New Living Translation? Could you be kind enough to do that for me? But if this is some of his qualifications, he said, let me see where we found that. But in all things, fourth verse, approving ourselves as ministers of God in much patience, in afflictions, in necessities, in distresses. So let's just pause a little bit. What do you think he's talking about? What do you think Paul is really laying out to us here? You can raise your hand. I know you got it in your spirit. In everything we do, we try to show that we are true ministers of God. We patiently endure troubles and hardships and calamities of every kind. Next verse. We have been beaten, been put in jail, faced angry mobs, worked to exhaustion, endured sleepless nights, and gone without food. We have proved ourselves by our purity, our understanding, our patience, our kindness, our sincere love, and the power of the Holy Spirit. We have faithfully preached the truth. God's power has been working in us. We have righteousness as our weapons, both to attack and to defend ourselves. We serve God whether people honor us or despise us, whether they slander us or praise us. We are honest, but they are called, but they call us imposters. We are well known, but we are treated as unknown. We live close to death, but here we are, still alive. We have been beaten within an inch of our lives. Our hearts ache, but we always have joy. We are poor, but we give spiritual riches to others. We own nothing, and yet we have everything. That is a powerful testimony. How many of you, just a flavor of his language as he is really setting things in order. And first of all, we recognize that he's in a conflict. He is light in a dark world. And how many of you agree that the world is not your friend? Do you also agree that we are not called to appeal to a world system? How many of you agree with that? That we are agents of the government of God, which the Lord refers to as the kingdom of the Lord. And you would also agree with me if I was to tell you that you are peculiar. Would you agree? Are you really peculiar? Peculiar means purchase, not strange. Yeah, strange too. All right. We are peculiar people. We are set aside. We've been called out of darkness into his marvelous light, and we should be the ones that show forth the praises of him who brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light. And yet we see the apostle pouring out his heart because this was his life. And I was talking to a group of ministers, and they were commenting on the effect of the pandemic, and they were commenting on, you know, maybe the people who have not returned back to church as of yet. And so they were just going back and forth, and they were kind of like just pouring out their woes. They were feeling this because obviously they had ministered unto people and poured out their heart into their lives, and so it was out of concern. And so, you know, I just made a conclusion to everything. I said, you know what? At the end of the day, we are measured by God based on our wounds. And that doesn't mean that I'm trying to get in the middle of the highway to catch a wound. I'm not going to say, I need to search out some wounds so I can say that I've arrived. They are going to come to you just because you're in this world. And so what God, you know, when Paul was expressing, you know, at one point to Corinth, he said, don't bother me anymore because I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, I'm going to tell you about my wounds. If you want to know really about glory, I'm not going to tell you about feel goods. I'm going to tell you about my afflictions and how God delivered me. I'm going to tell you how I was a day and a night in the deep, and yet he brought me out. I'm going to tell you how I was beat 39 stripes twice, and yet still I am here alive and strong. I can tell you when I didn't feel good, but he calls me to recover. And so I'll just give glory to God, not based on what the approval of people was, but how he rescued me in my time of need. and in that will I glorify him. Praise God. And so now we as humans, believers, we can now associate with that. We can identify with that because in this life, you probably have already found out that everything is just not easy peasy and that everybody may not agree with you at times or that there have been some wounds of heart. And yet you still stand sweet and kind and compassionate. You don't throw up walls and say, I'll never do that again. I'll never help anybody else again. I loaned them $10 and they haven't paid me back. And it's been 3 days now. And so you don't deal with these absolutes because that $10 was important to you. And so and you want to know for a little bit why God hasn't made them pay you back. And then when you really get real close to the Lord, from a standpoint of getting on your knees and you really want to find this information out, and then he just whispers to you, they're not going to pay you back. And then you want to do some shadow boxing, but who are you fighting? Wouldn't that be a great revelation for God just tell you, they're not going to pay you. They are not going to pay you. And then don't say nothing else. They don't give you, he doesn't give you no reason. He doesn't give you nothing. You say, well, now I understand. No, he just told you, they are not going to pay you back. And you got some kind of attitude with that. Maybe you haven't heard God, so you got to go hear from Prophet XYZ. So maybe Prophet XYZ can tell you something different because you need some resolve as to why you didn't get your $10 back. And you can quote the scriptures because they're going to reap what they sow. If you sow bad, you're going to get bad. But underlying there, your little anger over the $10, and I know some of your relatives too, if you had that attitude. Of course, I'm speaking in general because there's so many people that are listening online. And, I can't be talking about anybody here. But, you did have a relative, and I forget his name. It starts with a J, J-O something. But anyway, he was really upset over a gourd because a plant came up and gave him shade and died overnight because there was a noisome worm going in to eat that plant. And so Uncle Jonah, that's where it is. It's amazing what you can get upset with, a plant or $10. But you say, well, it's not the $10, it's the principle. That's what that's your next fail-safe place. It's the principle. They should know better. They were in Jesus before me. You're building your case, aren't you? I mean, and if you meditate on that long enough, you'll find more and more reasons why that person is not going to heaven. Just take it to the extreme. Just take it all the way. Because they did me wrong. They did me wrong. They did me wrong. Say that with me. They did me wrong. And you're really feeling some kind of way because God hasn't agreed with you that they did you wrong. He only said they're not going in the Greek to pay you back. Because sometimes ministers, they want to go off to the Greek a little bit. And whether it's the Greek or the English, it's still the same thing. They're not going to pay you back. And now he adds nothing else to it. And when he's not adding anything else to it, this is a growth moment. Because God is baiting you. God is bringing you in. He wants you to get good enough irritated so you can ask the right questions so he can give you profound truth. And you could leave it alone, but that's not your nature. No. And you could be doing praise and worship, and you look over and you see that person. And now you're cutting eyes just to see if they would dare lift their hands and owe you $10. You see, I'm using this, just to kind of reveal to you how God works with his people that he loves so dearly. that there comes times that he'll just recognize that you need to be on the grill. Or maybe if grill doesn't work because it's not warm outside, he's got ovens on the inside. And all of a sudden, you're the turkey that he's cooking. And as you heard me say before, you're crying out, well done. But he knows that that pink meat is not good to eat. Not turkey, not poultry. Not when you still see some red in the poultry. That's the indication that what? It is not done. And the Lord said to us about him saying, well done. To anybody who's had well done in their mind, that I'm going to stand before the Lord and I'm going to hear in that day, well done, is only because you are done well. And once again, you could talk about your growth now because of your oven time, not in your praises of men. And so finally you get down to the moment and you bring up your $10 again, and God said, he's not going to pay you back, and you can't pay me back. Can you? Can you? Oh, you forgot what you owed. So now that he wants to put all that you owe on a scale and against the $10 that you are so frustrated about, now we come bring in clarity as to how that doesn't matter. But we took a leap in growth when God gives us revelation and God gives us understanding. And then he said, and I need you to go give them $50 too. Now. I want you to do it now. And now you're going to say, but is that you, Lord? You know it's the Lord. You know the devil would not have you to give $50 to someone who owes you $10. That's right. Now, some people walk with Jesus no more over that. They just, and many no longer walk with him. So, we are not those type of people, because he's kind of taken this and showing us the extremes that has happened to his life. And now we are here 1,000 years later, and we're still gaining understanding by the Spirit of God, the expression of the Holy Spirit through this man of God, Paul. How he's saying that I'm going through all of this, but yet none of this took me through. In other words, it did not take precedent. I was lacking, but I know I got everything. I didn't have a lot of money, but I possess everything. I'm in distress, but I'm not destroyed and cast down, but I'm not put down forever. I'm going to rise again. Matter of fact, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Amen. So this helps us kind of think about whatever we would call a problem, that we can weigh it against how bad could be, against the way things are, so that our hearts can remain pure and we can be found good soldiers and great witnesses of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm not so sure if every believer is ready to be on that growth pattern, that they can endure hardship like a good soldier. I'm not talking about you, of course, I wouldn't do that. But to endure hardship like a good soldier. Do you not know the Bible says that any soldier that's a part of the army of God, I'm a paraphrase, does not entangle himself into the affairs of this world, but rather he seeks to please the one that enlisted him. You know, they got military police in the army. And if there's an infraction by the soldier, the military police, they have a whole different police and a way of dealing with their soldiers, because the army is supposed to supply everything for the soldier, his clothing, his shoes, his boots, his armament. And if he gets out of line, they got protocols for that also. And so he's not entangled with civilian affairs. He's really focused on his superiors and the laws that are laid down within the army or the branch of service that he's in. That's the same way with us. When God gave David the option, he said, now, do you want me to deal with you? Or do you want me to let these enemies that hate you deal with you? He said, no, I want you to deal with me, because I know you love me and they hate me, and you're full of mercy and they are not. They want me to go down, but you have the best in mind for me. So go ahead and deal with me as a father and bring correction. So you see him growing to the point where he says, search me, O God. Now he's getting real bold now. Search me, O God. You say, search me, O God. And see if there be anything in me that's not like you. That there's anything in me that you don't approve of. And this is not with you and the crowd. This is just with you and your God. Search me, O God. It's a one-on-one conversation. And so when we read 2 Corinthians, and like I said, this is not suggesting that we have to arrive to go through everything Paul went through. I'm not saying that at all. And Paul didn't go through what Jesus went through. Not even close. And nobody ever has gone through what Jesus went through. And what Jesus went through is not the nails, the scars, the beatings, and all those things. It's to have the sin of the whole world laid on him at one time, with all the feelings of that sin to be poured out on him. And I'm going to tell you what, that is what suffering really is. And so I want to just you go back and just kind of read through that and just say, man, this man of God went through in order for us to have something better. That's what parents do, isn't it? They make great sacrifices that we may have something better. And I want you, as you remember in 2 Corinthians, they use that word succor. Now, you could probably be fancy and say succor or something like that, but it's what it is. Let's look at it again. And this time we're going to go to the book of Hebrews chapter 2 and King James Version again. And I think, let's see where I want to start. Hebrews is such an exciting book, so I'm going to just kind of read some of it. It says, therefore, we ought to give more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast and every transgression and disobedience receive a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God also bearing them witness both with signs and wonders and divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. For unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world to come whereof we speak. But one in a certain place testifies, saying, what is man that you are mindful of him, or the son of man that you visited him? You have made him lower, a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor and did set him over the works of your hands. And you have put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he put all in subjection unto him, he left nothing that is not under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. Not everything is submitted in this world system yet. But we see Jesus, who is made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, and crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. Taste death is to fully dine on. He experienced death to its fullness. I want to go down a little further in the 14th verse. It says, "Forasmuch then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetimes subject to bondage. For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham." 17th verse. "Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brothers, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest." Everyone say merciful. And faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself hath suffered being tempted, he is able to, you want to change sucker, them that are tempted. Beautiful passage of scripture. "For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he's able to succor them that are tempted." I know that doesn't sound good to you, but just hold on. 17th verse again, "Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto us, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself hath suffered being tempted," that he has been suffered being tempted, "that he is able to succor them that are tempted." The word "succor" literally means to provide immediate assistance. To provide immediate assistance. Now, there are people who have gone to the hospital before. I've been to the hospital before. I've been to the doctor before. But I never had to have a squad call and pick me up. But if you dial 911, it's the indication that you need immediate assistance. Am I right? If you go to the emergency room, it's probably the indication that you need immediate assistance. And when I was down there praying for our dear brother I mentioned Sunday, I knew that in that moment he needed immediate assistance, that there was reports and questions and doubts and trying to figure out what was what and what was what. And I wasn't saying that they were not proficient in their skill and in their knowledge and all that, but I knew my brother needed immediate assistance. He needed the fact, the power of God to succor him, to provide immediate attention, to deal with his situation. That if I listened to the report, then I would have been sidetracked and failed to look to the one who has paid the price, tempted in every point as we are, didn't become an angel, but took on the likeness of manhood. He became like us, therefore tempted in every point like we are, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest who is able to help and provide immediate assistance. And somebody wrote a song and said, "I need you. I need you now." Have you ever been in a spot when you say, "I need you now"? I know in a land of abundance that we don't often say that we need him now because we have so many resources. We have so many things available to us to try first. But we're not the first to try things first. There's a lady who took 12 years and spent all her living trying to get fixed by the physicians. I'm for physicians. I celebrate them. Thank God for them. But even they know they are practicing. But the one who suffered and was tempted wasn't practicing. He was dealing with a reality. Yeah. See, Paul wasn't saying, I'm practicing ministry. I'm going to prove to you what ministry does. You can get cast down but not destroyed. You can be hungry but still filled with life. You can be beaten to the inch of your life and yet you still remain. They tried to kill me, but they can't kill me. And there is a confidence that Paul is exhibiting in his speech and his heart attitude that in spite of what the occurrences are in my life, that I know that greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. And so I hope none of you have to call 911, but if you do, I'm glad it's there. I'm glad that there are emergency procedures and emergency room doctors and physicians that can handle all the dynamics of that. Can you imagine what some of them may see, especially when you deal with big cities and the calamities that happen, what people do to other people? You know, everybody should know their lane. And I know that giving medical attention in an emergency room situation where there is blood, I'm not that person. You might as well call Maddie. Yeah, you could handle it, couldn't you? Yeah, you could. See, she's like that. I got you, Pastor. Don't worry about it. You don't have to go. Call me. And I will. I said, call Maddie. Because it would do no good for me to be in the emergency room on the floor. And the nurse said, well, who is that? And the person said, it's the mighty man of God, of faith. And then the nurse have to say, he looks like he needs some immediate attention. Well, that would be the case. It's just, I'm glad that you are there. But this area of Jesus, when you have to call on him, he says things like, I will answer. But calling on him in the nature of that scripture is not just, I'm going to call on the Lord, which you can at any time, and I just want to, you know, get a better job. The essence of this, I will call on the Lord, is that I'm in distress. The call is that I need him now. When Peter began to sink, he called on the Lord because he needed him now. And because of what Jesus had endured in just dealing with people and ministry for 3.5 years or so, he was more than able to pick Peter up from where he was, and they walked back to the boat together. Jairus was pinned. I mean, his heart is pinned because his little girl is sick. And he's got a wife there. Can you imagine what she was saying to him? And he's a Pharisee and he's a part of the Sanhedrin. And yet you got Jesus, the people I hang around with in my religious party. They don't like Jesus. They don't like him. But yet now Jairus is pressed in because he's got a daughter that's ill. And she is near unto death. Guess what he does? I could care less what my constituency thinks. I got to deal with this wife and my love for this daughter. I'm going to find Jesus. And so when he found Jesus, Jesus was getting off the boat in the shore. You know the story. Just coming from over in Decapolis, I believe. And sure enough, he falls down and worships the Lord. And so he begins to speak to him and tell him what the situation was. And Jesus said, I'm going to come. Well, relief has come. The master's coming to my house. Relief has come. But now we got this lady who's interrupting God because she's got issues. You know, you got your heart's got to be right when somebody else has an issue and they want to step in front of you. Just break the line and step in front of you. You got to make sure that you are the man of God and the woman of God. Because, see, I don't know too many things that'll get a believer more upset than somebody just kind of wandering around in the line, and they see you there, you're in line, and they're acting like they don't see you, and then they just kind of... See how a small thing, just this is that $10 we were talking about, but now it's less than $10, it's just cutting in line, and all you're saying is the principle. Has anybody been found guilty of that? That they know and intentionally just kind of edging their basket and you were there before them and so now you got to close the gap? And then where's your testimony about the Lord Jesus Christ? Here you are. Now she's 83 years old and you didn't know that part of the story. Yeah, she's 83 years old. She is hard on the legs to even stand. You got to celebrate the fact that she even wanted to come to Kroger's, and there because she couldn't see you because of glasses, she don't have them, and she can't see you, but you've got an attitude, and she's 83, and she is moving in, and she's in your space, and you're not having it today. Not today. And then you speak out, ma'am. And then she notices you. She said, yeah, baby. Baby, nothing. I got some rights here, and you're violating them. Let me just say this. That's one of the difficult things for believers, is to understand and grow and to understand that you don't have no rights. That all of your rights got nailed to the cross, so that you are now eligible for tender mercies. Come on now. Come on now. I said eligible for tender mercies in an hour when you need them now. And so now, since you did the right thing, I know you did the right thing in Kroger's with an 83-year-old, you did the right thing. Because, see, she needs to get through this line because... And you don't want to make a mistake. Well, she shouldn't be out here anyway. Suppose she would have said, you shouldn't be out here anyway. You're too young. If we start talking about rights. Well, sure enough, I know your heart. You would let that lady come in and break line, carry her groceries to her car, then reach in your pocket. And you don't have too many bills in there. So you're trying to sort out what 100 feels like versus a 10. And how are you going to do that, not look in your pocket, but you're going to maintain your coolness and your sainthood. And you're just hoping to God now that you're not going to pull out that 100. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? That you've ever done that before, trying to sort your money out? Because you want to give them some money, but you don't want to let them see what you have. Because you know you have two bills. You got a $100 bill and you got a $10 bill, and you want to give her the $10 bill. But God in heaven is laughing at you. And so here you are. She said, well, yeah, mother, it's no problem. She said, baby, thank you so much for bringing these groceries out to me. Just thank you so much. You said, no, mother, that's fine. Let me just give you something right there while you're having this war going on in your mind. And you're trying to get that 100 to see what it feels like. Seemed like that was the new bill. See, that was the new bill. So, and then so you go... It's amazing how God knows his people. And so you go ahead and say, no, I'm just going to bless you. And guess what you pull out? Now you've got too much gumption about you to pull that back. Because she's sitting there just looking. I mean, she got the, huh? Her eyes are not that good. Let me interpret that for you. Micah said he's going to do a pullback on her. and like left hand to the right hand, and I'm going back in. And come out with the 10. That's a rap song right there. But no, God had you to pull out that 100. You could have fumbled with them two bills for another 5 minutes and still would have lost. Because God is not just trying to bless her, he's trying to bless you. And you got 10 mentality, and God said you're going to need more than 10. You're going to need 100, because when you need him now, he's able to succor you and provide immediate assistance. And so now you've pulled out that 100. And you don't have a whole lot of time to pray. And don't talk about fasting often. It's too late. You were eating gummy bears before you got to the store. And then once you got in there, they were so good, you opened the package. How many of you open the package before you check out? Yeah, I'm just going to just eat the gummy bears while I'm shopping. And so now she starts crying. She starts crying. And she tells a story. She said, I didn't know how I was going to make it. But the Lord has provided. And when she mentioned the Lord, you don't say hallelujah conviction. Like, oh my goodness, I almost missed it. Because this is a child of God. And so you give that $100 up and you begin to thank God. Say, God, thank you for helping me with me. And I needed immediate assistance, so I would have gave her 10. I needed you to intervene. I need divine intervention. I need God now. So before we try to just unfold a bad situation with your health, let's just talk about a situation that seems so normal and something that seems so small. But you never know, the seed of good will sprout up in the hour that you need it. Because God is going to use something that you've surrendered to him, something that you obeyed him in, something that crucified you and killed and carved off your flesh. And then he takes his time and blesses you later, and you'll be wondering why he blessed you. And then he'll remind you of something you did a long time ago for him. And it goes on your record. Because when the 100 came out and she started crying, my goodness, your heart was moving. Now you go back rejoicing. You know, God used me today. God used me today. Saints, God used me. What did he do? He had me to give $100 to an old lady. Didn't tell him the rest of the part. Didn't tell him all the thoughts in your heart. Didn't tell them that you were fumbling in your pocket, not trying to give them that $100. You don't have to remember that anymore. The Lord's not going to remember it. God will never bring it up again. It's in the sea of forgetfulness. Forget about it. Just only tell about the $100 that you gave. It's okay, because you did give it. You could have pulled it back like Micah said. She would have never saw it. But guess who would have? So I made reference to Jairus. By the time the woman interrupted him and had her issue and touched the hem of his garment, meanwhile, the people came back and said, no need to bother Jesus because your daughter's dead. And Jesus stopped it. By the time that word got to Jairus' ear, Jesus said, focus on me, and I need you to believe on me. You need me now. And so he goes down there, and we find the mourners in there. And so what does he do? He threw them out. You. Out. And then he went to that daughter. and he raised her up. Mama needed him now, daddy needed him now, and the girl needed him now, and now he's paid the price through his temptations, his suffering through temptations, to provide immediate assistance for you. And what is this saying to us? There's nothing that you can call a challenge, an anguish, a distress, a broken heart that's not going to be used for the glory of God in the hour that all your training through suffering allows you and makes you eligible to declare the goodness of the Lord. I'm not telling you got to go out and search it. I'm just telling you it'll find you. 10 versus 100. Or $10 and $50. Do you think God would get the glory when you go to the brother and say, give me my $10 back, you scoundrel? No, he's not going to get the glory. He doesn't get the glory. He even said, if you want to give me the glory, then if they steal your coat, give them your cloak also, especially one that's made of real fur. That's how he measures success in growing in our identity with Christ. Not to mention, he said that if someone slaps you on one cheek, offer him the other one also. That's a security for your life. In other words, if a cop slap you, don't slap him back, because he's got authority to take you out. You can live with a slap, and nothing hurt but your feelings and your pride. Let it go. Just live to fight another day, okay? And so there's these little practical things that Jesus was dealing with that really happen every day in different forms in our life. Has anybody got on your nerves lately? You raise your hand if you had somebody that's on your nerves. Some of you got your hands up and your head down. What does that indicate? Come on, we're just family here tonight. We're not going to tell nobody much. But... But if somebody's really got you irritated, and now you're going to exercise your rights. And it sounds like this. You don't know who you're messing with. And then if you're a lady and you start taking off your ear... Now, why? You're a believer. Why are you slipping your earrings off? And then you're going to start slipping out your shoes? And I know that's not in the scripture how you start off praying for people. Yeah. You got plans to lay hands, but it's not the way Jesus said. Let's get some composure here, if it's possible. And sometimes we fail. Sometimes we fail the tests. And we think it was all the people, but God is showing you. God is just giving you real life in your face, opportunity to grow. Before you knew Jesus, you were fighting. But now, we look at all these distresses that Paul is listening to. Let's look at that again. Now we can look at it in a different lens, can't we? Can you give me that again in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 6 in the New Living Translation? Second Corinthians, you're waiting for a verse? Okay, I wish I could give you one. Let's see. I think the fourth verse, please. in New Living Translation. In everything we do, we try to show that we are true ministers. Pause. You are able, you think they talking, you think he's talking about me. He's talking about us. Because we are able ministers of the New Testament according to the scripture. In everything we do, we try to show that we are true ministers of God. We patiently endure troubles and hardships and calamities of every kind. We have been beaten, been put in jail, faced angry mobs, worked to exhaustion, endured sleepless nights, and gone without food. We have proved ourselves by, well, I've proved myself by our purity, our understanding, our patience, our kindness, our sincere love, and the power of the Holy Spirit. We have faithfully preached the truth. God's power has been working in us. We have righteousness as our weapon, both to attack and to defend ourselves. We serve God whether people honor us or despise us, whether they slander us or praise us. We are honest, but they call us imposters. We are well known, but we are treated as unknown. We live close to death, but here we are still alive. We have been beaten within an inch of our lives. Our hearts ache, but we always have joy. We are poor, but we give spiritual riches to others. We own nothing. Isn't that powerful? And yet, we have everything. That's good. So, as we look moving forward, and you're going to hear more of this, I think all of us at some point just want to continue to have an impact on God in our service, the things that we do for the Lord, and then the opportunities that we would have to speak with people. And before we get there, before we launch out, there's something that's so very, very important, especially about transitioning out of what is called a pandemic, which has really been a safety place for us. Have you noticed that? It's not that it didn't affect some of the saints. It's just simply saying that they were cast down but not destroyed. See, we celebrate that. We don't celebrate, oh, we never got it. No, 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 no. That's not where the glory is, that we got it and it didn't defeat us. There it is. That's the glory of God. And so it doesn't testify what may not happen. It just testifies to the fact of what God will be in our lives if it did. In spite of circumstances, I'm more than a conqueror through Christ who strengthens me. So therefore, I glory in infirmities. No one's out there, like I said, in the middle of the highway and said, please, infirmities, come to me. They will, depending on what you're trying to steal. If you're trying to take something from the enemy's clutches, then you're going to have opposition. So how do we anchor ourselves? How do we get ready for opportunity? In light of some degree, maybe a pushback or something like that. And so the Lord reminded me of something just the other day when I was talking to a brother, and it just set on fire in my heart because he had shared something with me that I had shared with you and with the church, and specifically with him, and he took it to heart. And I said, I got to tell the church that again. I knew it in my spirit, and I had to tell you again. And then God, after I got off the telephone, he began to minister once again to what you needed. And he said, you need him now. You say, okay. I agree with you, Pastor. I agree with you. Now, what does that mean? What does that mean? Are you trying to tell me you're going to take me out of my place of comfort? I'm not taking you anywhere. But I'm not going to stand for you to be deceived without me saying something. The nature of the pandemic, people right now want to travel. They want to get out and breathe. Have you noticed people want to, nothing wrong with traveling, but they just want to go somewhere. My problem is that when a person goes somewhere and come back and they didn't get nothing but time off, that nothing really met the need that you were really searching for, because COVID has kept me in the house and we couldn't travel, but now we're going to travel. And then again, at the end of the travel, things are kind of still the same. And these things ought not be. If you were to go anywhere, you should be able to go outside and see God in the trees. That if you walk on green grass, that you see God in everything that he made. And the resurrected Christ inside of you stands up and declare who he was and who he is and who he shall be. And so that once you leave the trip and you come back from the trip, you still give God the glory, because it's like Dorothy. Everything she needed was in her backyard. There is no place like home. There is no place like home. And by the way, you always had the power. Just click your heels together. You could always go back. You could always go back. And you could always go back to Jesus. So you say, Pastor, what is it? You mean you built all of this up to tell us this? Yes. Because I want to be a faithful servant. Amen? Just like you. You want to be a faithful servant. A faithful servant. You don't want to be driven around with every wind of doctrine and every new thing. You want to be anchored. If you keep running, you'll never be have the privilege to endure hardship like a good soldier. And so what the Lord reminded me of was so simple. And you said, Pastor, are you going to say something about fasting? She said, perish the thought. She is not on that list. We've been without food. It's not me. Fasting is good. It is good. But I tell you what, here's something that you could, if you want to fast, fast from TV and social media. I was just not too long ago ministering to a couple. The things are falling apart because they don't communicate. They say they don't communicate because when he wants to talk to her, she is. On social media. And then when she wants to talk to him, he's on his phone. Not talking on it. You know, just doing the thumb thing. And all of a sudden, what is a benefit is now becoming a snare. So if you want to fast, you can begin there. Because, you know, I'm not so sure you're going to do food and social media and let me get out of here alive. So he brought up this thing, this truth in my heart about you needing him now. So if you need him now, then there's something now that you should do.
So we're back to this landing spot, this great spot of reading a book of the Bible a day. Before you go on a travel trip, and while you're on your travel trip, don't forsake your book of the Bible a day. Because it's the only way to make your trip fulfilling. Don't be deceived that I got to get out because I've been held back by COVID. You haven't been held back by COVID. You've been given opportunity by God. And so, you know, I won't just go on vacation. I just want to go on vacation. But when do you get to go on vacation from the word of the Lord? And so now we elevate it. Is everybody listening? Or are you tuning me out? Because it is possible in some other church somewhere in another part of the country, they would have already said no in their spirit. No, I know I'm not going to do that. I know I still want my $10 back, and that old lady is not going to cut in line on me. I know you labored well, Pastor, but my answer is no. And I'll see you in a month or so. I'll be here for you. So this is a big, great opportunity, is to go back and maybe you continue on doing it like you just do it because you do it. But it would be good that if we collectively as a body pursue this with the Lord, because it will gain you great benefit. It'll gain you great benefit, because what the church needs now is not to get out. They need to go in. There's nothing in the world you're going to see unless you see it through the lens of the Word of God. That there is no view that you can obtain or place you can travel to without the ministry of the Holy Spirit making it alive to you, so that you could have got the same thing in your backyard as you would and went and spent $1,000 to go and see. But wouldn't it be a tragedy to spend $500 to go somewhere and you went there malnourished and you came back the same way? And don't take this as me being harsh. I'm not being harsh. I just want to know if this church agrees with me. I know maybe there are some people in the country that don't even think that's necessary. I remember preaching this, and I was down near Raleigh, North Carolina. And I was invited to this particular church. And I ministered this message about a book of the Bible. And I used the same examples. I said, who goes through a drive-thru to get McDonald's hot fries? You better get them hot, because if they ever turn cold, they could impale you. So I think while they're hot, we're open for deception as if they're good. But nonetheless, when they said, do you want to supersize them? And you said, of course I do. You can supersize them for free. That's trying to get you addicted. And you said, of course. So then you get this big box, but when you look in there, it's only one fry. Now, you got to supersize, but it's only one fry. That's how it is when you say, I read my scripture for the day. Whoever told you that a scripture for the day, a verse for the day, is going to sustain you? I wonder where in the world we got that from. Because you will get out of your car, and it's raining, but you're going to get out of your car, and I want to speak to the manager. Your mask is hanging all off your ear, but you don't care. You got to love God's people. You just got out of Bible study. And that one fry, that was the straw that broke the camel's back. So you're going to take your time, park your car, forget about an umbrella, mask hanging off the ear, and I want to see the manager. They gave me one fry in the supersize. And the manager said, oh, you must have been reading one scripture per day. Yeah, then you're going to have rights now, because you got to write, McDonald's and tell them about that. But you wouldn't tolerate a one fry, and you probably don't want to tolerate my scripture for the day. Let me go read my promise book for the day. I'm going to read my verse for the day. So preparation is that you feast. And you feast by doing something that it becomes necessary, because God is reminding us of what it's going to take to survive the other side of the pandemic. Because I'm going to tell you, you were safer in the pandemic. I know it doesn't sound like it's good news, but it's great news. You save gas, didn't you? But now that it's $3, you don't care. I'm driving. No problem with that. None whatsoever. Enjoy yourself. But what it's going to take so that you are not tainted by all the confusion and the noise and the lies of this world system that is coming at you to occupy space in your spirit. Say amen. But this word will fill us up. And you say, well, what should I read? You got 66 books to choose from. Just a smorgasbord of word. And if you're like me, you just get up in the morning and you just, and you know, when I was just going in this morning, I didn't turn the TV on or anything like that. And I don't do social media, so I don't even know how to do that. And so I was just going, and that word sucker popped out, and I know the Holy Spirit was on it. I knew it. I knew it when I saw it. I said, I've been reading this book all my believing life, and all of a sudden that word pops out. What in the world does it mean? The one that can help and provide immediate attention to whatever you need. I will never leave you or forsake you. And in times where I have to exert something, and that's what I told our brother Troy, I said, it's not like God is not with you, but there's a season where he exerts something. The same strength that he exerted when he raised Jesus from the dead. He was there with Jesus, but that's something he exerted to bring him out of the grave. And it's something he's going to exert to bring us out of the grave. And so his seriousness about the word of God. You're going to have the devil fight you. Are y'all listening to me? He is going to fight you over this simplicity. He is going to bring up every agenda, what you got to do. I didn't say you got to read it in the first setting, but if you don't get it in the first setting, you'll get sleepy. And all of a sudden, I tried to listen to the Bible, and guess what I did? This is a great, who needs melatonin? Just play the Bible out loud while you're laying down in a posture, and I'm just going to hear the word of God. And before that dude had got to Hebrews 9, I checked out at Hebrews 7. So I said, oh, no, this is not going to do. So I went right back to 7, and I started again so I could get it ingested into my spirit. And how many of you understand and receive what I'm saying? Yeah. Everybody wants to know, what am I going to do? What should I do? What should I do? What should I do? And before the do, you got to be fed by seemingly things that you already know, but then sucker comes alive. Pow! I am ready to help and provide immediate assistance. 911. Right now. Even the doctors tell you, say, if you call in and if you, this is a medical emergency, dial, hang up.
and dial 911. How do you hang up and dial 911? Oh, I know. You say they're starting to say hang up and start a new call. Okay. Well, we don't hang up anymore. We push buttons. Right? And I think if we have to dial 911 because of trouble, then we can go the extra mile because we're not in trouble. It's the joy to enter in to finding out what God has to say to us. How many of you know you can read a book of the Bible a day? How many of you know that? That it can be done. It can be done. How long do you think it really took me to read Hebrews? What do you think? It's 13 chapters. How long do you think? 2 hours? Okay. 45 minutes. I could cruise through it in 45 minutes. Okay. How long? Well, let me just turn it on you. How long did it take you to read Hebrews? 35 minutes? You can knock it out in 35 minutes. Yeah, about 4 hours for me. Huh? 2 months. 2 months. Forget about a day. That's pretty good now. But why 4 hours? Now, for me, I try to go through it. I could read it in 30 minutes. I could. 30, 35 minutes, I could just cruise through it. But when in chapter 2, I'm stuck on that one word. Well, I'm spending another 30 minutes on that word. Then he begins to minister to me about that word, that one word. And then he begins to bring up all the history about Jairus' daughter and Daniel in the lion's den, who needed him now. He needed him now. And then only to turn on me, he said, my people need me now. And when you go into the word of God, you find out what you really need. Not being in the word of God, you find out what you need. It's when you go to the word of God, you find out what you really need. You find out what is really necessary in the word of the Lord. Did you understand that? I'm going to the word of God because I need. No, I go to the word of God and I find out what I need. Oh, really? Yeah, and that's the beauty of it, the bounty of it. And so anybody know already what book you're going to start with? Raise your hand if you know what book you're going to start with. You do, Roz? Philemon? Jude? Well, Jude is a book of the Bible. It is. Yeah, she's going to start tonight. She's going to do Jude. Bless your heart. Now, there was a brother who's told me that he was reading Jude every day for like 2 weeks. I didn't argue with him a bit. I celebrate him because he was reading. Yeah. And, but, you know, maybe you want to move on a little bit. When you start reading that low-hanging fruit when you're busy, I'm going to just hit this low-hanging fruit, then it just becomes systematically, methodically, and maybe not really saying, Lord, what do you want to say today? Where do you want me? That's what I asked him. I asked him this morning. I said, God, where do you want me to go? And Hebrews was where he wanted me to go because he had something to say to me in Hebrews. He knows what he's doing. And I know his voice, and you know his voice too. It didn't speak out loud, but it was just in my heart. Hebrews was just right. And then from that is where he led me to 2 Corinthians.
And tonight, that's what I delivered, because he fixed the meal, I brought it out on the platter, and I hope you benefited from it. So all other words is just, you know, self-promotions of what you're doing, or another person may say, this is happening, and there's no concrete foundation, then that building will tilt. Lay your foundation. And I'm convinced that you love Jesus. I know he loves you. Take full advantage of what he has. And if this means for you to pause, to slow down, make it happen, you'll be glad that you did. So you know you're going to do Jude. Anybody else know already? Raise your hand. You know what book you're doing. You're Luke? Okay, that's good. Philemon. All right. Anybody else? Where are we? You're going to go with Mark? Mark is it makes it happen quick. 16 chapters, but I tell you what, it shows Jesus is a man of action. He's a man of getting it done in the book of Mark. It is dense. Mark is dense. It's got a lot of information, and it moves real fast. Very good. Yes, sir. I was waiting for a young man to raise his hand. Oh, you're going with Romans. Okay, that's the Pauline masterpiece. You'll start with the book of Esther. Powerful book. How about you, Andrea? First Peter. Okay, North Carolina? First Chronicles. Ooh, go for the deep seas. Genesis. Yes. Yes, sir, brother.
I'm going to do Ephesians.
Ephesians. Yeah, that's good. Ephesians. So I think we got the idea. And I wanted to press in a little bit so that you understand, you know, God does mean this. And he will meet you there. He will meet you there. Now, if by chance God changes you or you change your mind and want to go to Jude, you're okay. But not Jude every day. And you say, well, Pastor, how long is this going to last? Who knows? Let God tell you that. How long you want to be blessed? How long you want to be filled with the Spirit of God? How long you want to know truth that puts down every lie? How long you want to be able to walk in the anointing of the Holy Ghost and speak the word of God and it come to pass what God put in your mouth. In the hour you need to speak, the Lord fills your mouth. Or how long do you want blessing going in and blessing coming out? How long do you want to know the mind of God, the heart of God, and the will of God? How long? That you're going to lead him later instead of needing him now. Let's stand now. I got excited for a moment, and that's typically not me. All right, then, Miss Liz, we're gonna go after I ask you, and I'm gonna ask Miss Vanessa, and then I'm gonna come around here. No, I'm not. What do you think, John? John's my precious book. I love John. I love John. And Miss Vanessa. Wow. Deuteronomy. Everybody gonna be walking in holiness. Yes. I was waiting for somebody to say, I'm doing Leviticus. And I'm just gonna bow down right now and say, I'm undone. Yeah. Okay, Miss Katie. Hosea. Come on now. Wow. Wow, that fella, you're gonna learn a lot in Hosea. Yeah, about his constitution and what he was called to do. What was he called to do since you Bible readers already read it? To be faithful to somebody who was not faithful. Isn't that something? But then he loved her. Yeah, and then she still wasn't faithful. I'm going to tell you, Hosea's a book now, because you'll be reading through that and say, that's not me, that's not me, that's not, no, I am not doing that. Yeah, okay.
First and Second Timothy.
You're going to do two books. Come on now. That's Libby's son-in-law. See, ain't nobody but Libby's son-in-law will come up with that one. All right, Justin, come on, Tick. First John. First John is good. Sitka.
Jeremiah.
The weeping prophet. Yeah. He walked around, Jeremiah walked around with the burden of the Lord. In other words, he was feeling what God was feeling, the burden of the Lord. This has been fantastic. And if we jumpstart together, we do this together. And pray for your brothers and sisters, because I'm going to deliver this Sunday. I'm going to share it at least Sunday. And so you get a jumpstart. And because it's necessary, and it can only do good and bring glory to the Lord, as it sensitizes your spirit. And if he said you can't live except by the word of God, you know, can't live by bread alone, but by every word of the, then we should pursue every word so that we can live. We should not conclude, I can live and I don't have to have the word of God. But that's not what he's saying. You don't know, a person may not know, I'm not speaking to you. They really won't know how dead they are until they go into the word. And then when they come resurrected to life, you say, oh my goodness, how could I have spent so much time on those soap operas? Father, in the name of Jesus, I hope you're laughing like we are. We love you and we thank you, Lord God, for ever giving us instruction. We praise you now in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.